Good evening, sir. Saxena, sir. Good evening.
Yeah, good evening. How are you? Nice to see you.
Just wait. Participants, respected faculties and panelists, also our attraction, main attraction, Dr. Unnil Saxena with us, also demonstrator, CRM, about CRM. Everybody knows Dr. Unnil Saxena is an internationally acknowledged expert in the field of cardiac arrhythmia and electrophysiology. Since joining Fortis Scott Heart Institute in 1989, Dr. Saxena has been actively involved in setting up the Department of Cardiac Electrophysiology. He was one of the pioneers in implantation of the ICD and biventricular pacemakers in India, and has one of the largest experience in the field. He has been performing electrophysiology studies and radio frequency ablation for various complex cardiac arrhythmia for over 25 years, with thousands of successful procedures to his credit. Lots of students and trainees in Bangladesh also here. Ladies and gentlemen, my dear colleagues and participant faculties, so we start out with these topics. Which ABC of pacemaker is series 2. Professor Abdul Aziz sir, please tell us your comments regarding this.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Good afternoon, everybody. Assalamu alaikum. I hope that all of you are quite well. Actually, what Mohsin was saying, Unnil Saxena is not only a great electrophysiologist, but to me, the most important aspect of his, resume is that he's an excellent teacher. He knows how to make things simple to describe to different type of audience the same material in different degree of relevance. For young novices, he will give one lecture. For the expert, he will give another lecture, and everybody will find something relevant in their participation, and they will learn something. This is something remarkable. Without much ado, I would ask Professor Unnil Saxena to start his lecture. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Unnil Saxena.
Can you see my presentation?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon, Dr. Mohsin, Dr. Professor Chaudhary, Professor Jalaluddin, Dr. Atahar. Thank you for having me here. And good afternoon, all the listeners. So today, I will take up the second part of the basics of pacing, that is implantation, follow-up, and troubleshooting. And as we mentioned last time, I have kept it somewhat simple, relevant to the needs of postgraduates. Now, even we discussed the basics and structure of the pacemaker, how it functions. And today I want to discuss the implant and the follow-up. So before we decide to implant the pacemaker, we have to define the indication for pacing for our patient. We have to decide whether we want to use single chamber or dual chamber. We discussed the advantages last time. And most of the times we prefer a dual chamber these days, and also with or without rate modulation. So patients who have a good sinus rate activity, we can use a pacemaker without a sensor. But in most cases nowadays, we prefer to use a rate modulation driven pacemaker. And of course, patient education is very important. Patients should be told about the need for device, expectations, what are the limitations, where it will be done, who will be doing it, and some subsequent course after the implant. And patients should also know about possible harms or complications that can come from pacemaker. Especially, everybody should be aware that infection can happen in 1%, 1.5% patients. And most of the time, it can be managed with the antibiotics and local. But rarely it may happen that the pacemaker may have to be taken out and removed. So that patient knows in the mind, and the family also knows that this is one possible eventuality, and they should go into the procedure knowing fully well that this can happen. Otherwise, in today's environment, it's becoming increasingly difficult for doctors to defend themselves subsequently if the patient is not aware of possible outcomes. Implant team consists now of cardiologists. There was a time when only cardiac surgeons used to implant about 20, 30 years back, but most of the pacemakers are now implanted by cardiologists. But I still suggest that for the young implanters who start their program, it may be a good idea for some time they can involve a surgeon. Surgeons definitely are much better in pocket, in forming the pocket and in stitching, etc., which are equally important to have a good outcome, because if the wound doesn't heal properly, then everything is lost. So it's very important to learn the techniques of basic surgery from surgeons. And of course, it's always helpful if anesthesiologist is present in the cath lab. We have the luxury of having an anesthesiologist all the time in cath lab, so we always take help from them. Of course, the nurses are quite capable in the cath lab also, but they still they are not as used to the hygienic way of working as OT nurses. And it may be a good idea to send the nurses by rotation to OT to learn how, to see how, observe how they behave there, how carefully they prepare everything in a most sterile manner, because it is something different as compared to intervention, where we are doing just subcutaneous punctures and surgery is not involved, implantables are not involved. But in a device implant, we have to be extremely careful about maintaining a proper hygiene and sterility. Cath lab technician should be present, and one company representative is usually there for technical support, and they bring all the equipment. And we must make sure that everything is available, that whatever we need during the implant, because it's very embarrassing if you start the procedure and some particular thing is not available, which can happen because of somebody else's mistake. So you must make sure that pulse generator is available, appropriate leads are available, pacing system analyzer, threshold testing cables, appropriate programmer, sterile sleeves. It may sometimes be required to check the threshold after implantation. And of course, for replacement, whenever patient is undergoing a replacement or revision, we have to study the existing hardware thoroughly, because sometimes it may happen that one particular hardware is in recall. For example, some lead may be in recall. And when you change the device, it should not happen that you change the device and the lead is left in the body because it was in recall. Or supposing the pacemaker is in recall and patient comes for lead revision because of fracture or some improper performance of the lead, and you reposition or replace the lead and the pacemaker, you put the same pacemaker back even though it was in recall. So all these things should be understood, and basically one should try to find out if any of the existing hardware is in recall or not. And appropriate stylets, screwdrivers, lead sleeves, etc., everything should be available, and you can verify that from the tech support. Pre-implantation is very similar to all surgeries. We do all routine pre-implant tests. And we must also, whenever we do a pacemaker, we must immediately ask the patient, are you taking any blood thinner? And if patient is taking some blood thinner, whether it's anticoagulant or antiplatelet for some non-critical reason, for example, somebody may be taking anticoagulant for atrial fibrillation, where we can stop it for 2-3 days. If one is taking it for mitral valve replacement or mechanical heart valve, then we have to be very careful. Then we just allow INR to drop to 1.5 to 2, and then we do the procedure without giving heparin. And then immediately after procedure, we can give the next dose because the effect will come after some time. Informed consent, shaving apart, draping, everything. Fasting state should be maintained for at least 5 to 6 hours. An antibiotic injection should be given 1 hour before the skin incision. That's very important for the antibiotic action to come. And usually we are using one antibiotic which covers a staphylococcus, say teicoplanin, or earlier vancomycin was used, but now teicoplanin is what we use, that is Targocid. And one other broad spectrum usually is fortrexime or something, whatever, can be used, which also covers gram-negative. And subsequently, after 48 hours, we switch to oral, and usually we use Augmentin, that is amoxicillin-clavulanic acid combination. Now, a patient should be mildly sedated, remove all dentures, oxygen mask is put, and we connect ECG and NIBP and oximetry. Now, it is very good to connect non-invasive blood pressure if invasive is not present, and oximetry. If you keep periodically looking at screen and the blood pressure and oxygen saturation is good, then you know you're relaxed, your patient is doing fine. You have ECG monitored, you have oxygenation monitored, and you have NIBP monitored, then you can work peacefully. And of course, we clean and scrub the implant site very carefully, and proper draping with the iodine film, and the C-arm should also be covered. Now, the choice of implant site, mostly it is implanted in the pectoral area. Right or left-handed decides whether we put it on right side or left side. Nowadays, we prefer on the left side because it is very convenient. And not only that, if you see why we should prefer left side, it is that the curvature. If you see the this thing is absolutely, you can see the it is following the natural curve. While if you do on the right side, you have multiple multiple angles. Yeah, you can see that there are multiple angles of lead placement here. So when you place the lead, you find you encounter multiple angles, and that can be take some more time. But once you get used to, you can do right-sided, left-sided, it doesn't matter. It can make a difference of 1 or 2 minutes. But left-sided comes in very, very handy. Most are done so in the pectoral area. And as I said, local conditions can sometimes affect the implant. And it could be venous anomalies. It could be infection or dermatitis. It could be some previous surgery, or it could be clavicular fracture. So like you can see in this patient on the left side, we have a patient who has undergone mastectomy. So there may be some disruption in the tissues inside, and you may encounter some abnormality there, or some patient may have a fractured clavicle previously. So the venous anatomy, the landmarks may not be proper, but in most cases, it should not be a problem. As far as anesthesia is concerned, we use it in local, we do it in local anesthesia and with deep sedation. But sometimes, if patient is very restless or violent, we may require general anesthesia, although that situation may not come for a very long time, say maybe once in a couple of years. So it should never happen. A instrument trolley should be properly prepared, and all the instruments should be there. In our hospital, we have multiple trays available for multiple procedures. You don't need so many equipments as shown in this particular tray, but you must have scalpel, retractors, dissection scissors, and tooth forceps, and retractors, and needle holders, sutures. All these things should be available. Venous access, usually we use subclavian or axillary vein puncture. Sometimes cephalic vein puncture may be required as a rare approach. Although it is something very good, I will tell you why. Then pacemaker pocket is made either subcutaneous or submuscular. Usually 99% we make subcutaneous pocket only, just above the pectoral fascia. Rarely we may require a submuscular pocket in a very thin emaciated patient. And then of course we position the lead. Now this picture I want you to concentrate on for a minute or so. It is very, very important picture because it shows the relationship of jugular of the subclavian vein. See, up to the outer margin of first rib, we call it subclavian up to this point. And then it becomes the axillary. So we like to puncture the vein somewhere here where it is exposed. If you puncture it very medially, then your puncture is going through subclavius or it's very close to the clavicle. So your lead will also follow the same route because the way you puncture, your wire goes the same way, your sheath goes the same way, your lead goes the same way. Then there is more chance of friction with the clavicle or the lead getting trapped in the muscle tissue or tendinous tissue. And subsequent forces may act on the lead and cause disruption in the lead structure or body, and there may be deterioration in the lead function. But if you puncture the vein here, then the lead is inside the vein. And once the lead is inside the vein, it is protected from everything because the vein has its own natural space. So it goes inside within this portion. And as I was saying, this cephalic vein cut down, if you do cephalic vein cut down, then your leads go into the subclavian vein right here. So they are then protected from any bad influence of external influence of the clavicle, etc. So the long-term lead performance is very good if you do cephalic vein cut down, or if you do axillary vein puncture, or if you do subclavian vein puncture quite laterally. So that's very, very important. Otherwise, what can happen is that if your lead is very close to the clavicle, then it can fracture because of constant pressure from the clavicle. It may get crushed because it may get trapped between the clavicle and first rib, and that can be a problem. And you can see this kind of thing can happen, and you can even see a periosteal reaction because of the lead in the clavicle. So this can be a problem. So what this patient came with a lead fracture, and you see where we are puncturing now, puncture very, very lateral to the clavicle, so that there is no chance of the lead will be already inside the vein here, so that it is not exposed to the pressure by the clavicle or any external tissue. So that is how we should try, that we should do as lateral puncture as possible beyond the clavicle. So this is the way we do cephalic vein cut down rarely. So this is the deltopectoral groove, and this is in the groove we make incision, and then we can find this vein here. So I'll not go into the details. Now coming to the, this is the site of the subclavian axillary vein puncture. And that's how we put the wire to the atria, right atrium. Then we take out the needle, we put a sheath there, and then we put the lead inside. Now, one important point is that now the lead is finding difficult to go because the sheath is very much deep in. And if you put the sheath in too much, it starts hitting on the superior vena cava wall. And then the lead finds it difficult to go inside. So you see the sheath is right up to this point, which is not a good thing to do. So you need to keep the sheath right up to here so that the lead can bend. So you need to pull back the sheath so that the lead can bend, and then it can go into the right atrium. And after that, your job is like, this is a ventricular lead. That's what we do. We typically put the ventricular lead first. Now, when you're inserting the lead, what is important is that you must avoid the certain precautions to be taken. One is to avoid air embolism. So when we take out the dilator and we try to put the lead into the sheath, we must grip that sheath from outside and press it so that there is no air can go inside. And to avoid air embolism, you can do two things. One is that patient should be very well hydrated, because if patient is not hydrated, then there is a negative venous pressure, and that can pull the air in. And second thing is that we must keep the sheath pinched from outside, and we don't, as I said, push the sheath too high, too deep. We keep stillet slightly away from the tip, and we don't push anything hard against any resistance, because we are putting the lead in the vein, and the veins are very, very delicate. One thing which is very important is that all the complications of the pacemaker, they are related to the lead placement. Whether acutely, like pneumothorax, hemothorax, hemopneumothorax, air embolism, chylothorax, brachial plexus injury, arterial puncture or tear, all these occur because when we try to place the lead inside the body. And the chronic complications of pacemaker, like rib clavicle crush, conductor fracture, damaged insulation, all these are related to the lead. So lead is a weak link in the pacing system. And that is something we have to understand. Pacemaker, as such, the main body of the pacemaker, the box, it doesn't malfunction most of the time. So our practice is like this, that we put two punctures, depending on whether we are doing single or dual chamber pacemaker. We put one or two pacemaker punctures, and then put wires inside, and then we make an incision, and then we take out the wires through the incision, and then make a pocket. Now, when we make a pocket, it is very important that we make a pocket in a manner that it should not go very laterally. We try to make as medial pocket as possible, because the reason is that we don't want the pacemaker device to project into the axilla, because that not only becomes painful to the patient, but also skin more often. So we try to make as medial pocket as possible. And then we decide which pacemaker lead to choose, whether active fixation or passive fixation. There was a time 10, 15 years ago when we used to do mostly tined leads. There was a fear of causing perforation by active fixation. But off late, we have practically given up. For last 10 years, we have now we don't use tined leads at all, because the quality of active fixation leads is very good, and they can be fixed anywhere. They don't perforate. I mean, you have to be careful. So we have learned a technique so that we don't perforate the ventricle. Right? Yeah. Now, the advantages are that, as I said, one is the fixation. It is actively fixed, so it doesn't usually dislocate. The thresholds are now very good, and longevity is very good, and removal is also very easy compared to the tined lead. So active fixation leads are, of course, now preferred by everybody, but there are certain situations where we have to use active fixation only. We can't use tined leads, which are patients with previous cardiac surgery or cardiopulmonary bypass. So in case of atrium, for the tined lead, we need an atrial appendage. And atrial appendage may be lost in patients who undergo previous cardiac surgery. And then we have patients who have severe tricuspid regurgitation. There may be chance of dislocation of the atrial lead. There is severe TR. So we must use active fixation there. In case of ventricle, if the right ventricle is very much dilated, then the trabeculations may be lost, or they may not hold the lead properly. So we should try to use active fixation. And patients who have severe TR, then we have to use active fixation. And when we want to put it in septum, we have to use TR. Active fixation lead. Otherwise, we can use tined lead also. So tines, they get entrapped in the trabeculae, and then they become fixed also after some time. And one important thing about the atrial lead is that we have to be careful that we have to maintain just the right amount of slack here. If the slack is too much, then the lead will fall down. If the slack is less, then also it may get dislocated because of the pulling effect. And sometimes we have to use these active fixation leads on the epicardium, which may be of different configuration. And they have a screw also, and they have a Dacron patch also, which can be sutured. So they have multiple fixation mechanisms. So with that screw in, as I said, the fixation is better. There is less chance of dislodgement. One complication which can be seen sometimes is myocardial perforation. So the care to be taken is that when we are screwing the lead, we do not keep the stylet up to the tip. We keep it a bit 2-3 centimeters short of the tip, so that there is less pressure onto the myocardium and chances of perforation are then reduced. So put the lead in the RV apex. We take the lead into the right atrium, then put a curved stylet, and then gently pass across the tricuspid valve, and then take it either to the septum or to the apex. In this case, it has been taken to the apex, and then we can just give the right amount of slack, take out the slit, and then we fix it there. So this is at the apex, right ventricle apex. You can see that it is even beyond the temporary pacemaker tip. But off late, for last few years, we are doing almost always a mid-septal pacing. And this is where the position is of the mid-septum. The advantage is that the QRS is narrow and it engages the conduction system. So the QRS becomes narrow, and these patients, they have a better cardiac output and LV function over long term. So that's how it looks in the PA view, and that's how it looks in the LAO view. It should point towards the spine. For the atrial lead, again, we take the lead up to the right atrium, and then we take a J stylet, or if the tined lead is already J shaped. So when you introduce it, it automatically takes the shape and tends to go into the RA appendage. And when it goes into RA appendage, you can see this viper-like movement of the tip. So like a car wiper, and that's very characteristic. And you can check it in the LEO view, it should point towards the left side. So this is a typical positioning of the RA and RV catheter lead in the, and this is how it looks in the LEO view. It should point anteriorly away from the spine. So that's how these leads look. This is a right ventricular lead at the apex, and this is a RA and RV lead both at the apex. And of course, we assess the position by fluoroscopy and by tugging of the lead and by making the patient cough or taking deep breath. And then we check the leads connections. We connect with the threshold cable. We take RA, RP, R wave, and P wave measurement. We check the threshold lead impedance, and we check for diaphragmatic stimulation. The leads like this. The black connector is connected to the tip and red to the ring. So remember the mnemonic red on the ring. So that's how you will always remember that when you connect the red to the ring, ring is the anode and the black is the tip is the cathode. So which is connected to minus, and the ring, which is anode, is connected to the plus, which is represented by red. And this is how a typical cath lab would look like. You have a tech support standing far left with the PSA, and who's monitoring the thresholds, etc., and the surgeon is helping there. Now, typically the threshold should be less than one in all atrial and ventricular. Atrial may be slightly higher, and the P wave or R wave, the P wave should be at least one or more. Usually we get about 2 to 5, and the R wave should be above 5. Usually we get around 5 to 15. And impedance usually is between 400 and 1000 for all the leads. There was a time when most of the leads would have 400 to 700 or 600. But now the manufacturers are making leads with higher impedance because they will pass less electric current, and they somehow they make the battery last longer because they have a higher impedance, so less current will pass through them and the battery will last longer. Then it's very important that what you see is a sleeve on the lead, and every sleeve has 2 or 3 grooves on which we put the ligature, and the ligature should not be very tight or very loose. So that's also very, very important. And then we connect the leads to the pacemaker. Now all the pacemakers have a what we call IS1 connector, which is a standard connector across manufacturers. So leads from one manufacturer can be used in other pacemakers also. And it is very important to check that the lead has gone through the tip. So we must make sure that it goes right through the tip so that, and we check it on X-ray also, so that there's no embarrassment subsequently if the lead is not properly fixed. And then we make a coil of the lead and put the device in the pace in the inside the body. And then we can once again verify on fluoroscopy that everything is in proper position. So that is the procedure. And of course, we must do proper stitching. Stitching is equally important, and closure of the deeper layer is very, very crucial. So you must make sure that the deep layers are approximated very well, because that will decide how thick the scar becomes over the pacemaker. If the deep layer is not approximated and doesn't close properly, then the skin gets closed, then the scar becomes very thin. And after some time, there is a depression at the suture line, and those scars become very prone for subsequent erosion. And one must complete all the paperwork, etc. So all that is very important. So that completes the implantation procedure. So I've taken about 30 minutes in this, and now I'll discuss the follow-up and troubleshooting in next 30 minutes. So when a patient comes back to you after implantation or goes home, we have to give some advice to the patient and family. And based on physicians' advice and the patient's medical condition, most of them can return to work, they can travel, they can safely take bath, shower, pursue their hobbies, recreational activities, and pretty much do everything like a normal life. But initially they have to take some precautions. So patients are advised to have homebound activity for about 1 week. They should avoid jerky movement or travel for 3 to 4 weeks, like in an auto rickshaw or something. because sometimes the leads can dislocate, especially if it is not active fixation lead, there is higher chance of dislocation. And sometimes there is a tendency, you see, first day the nurses and the doctors will advise the patient, don't move your shoulder. And the patients take that advice very, very serious, and they take it to the heart and they stop moving the shoulder and they develop periarthritis or frozen shoulder. So that is something we have to actively advise the patient that they should start a movement of shoulder from second day onwards, increasing it by 10, 20 degree every day, so that by 1 week or 10 days, they have a full range of movement of the shoulder, and they should do it every day, 5 minutes or 10 minutes in the morning and evening. Otherwise, they tend to develop a frozen shoulder, which becomes a long-term problem. Patients should carry device several times, and they should inform the healthcare providers about they have the device implant, because some procedures and some investigations may require some adjustment in the pacemaker, especially radiotherapy, especially MRI, lithotripsy, and all that. So they should inform the doctor that they have a pacemaker inside the body. Now, your patients will have numerous questions about the device, and mainly related to the electromagnetic interference, because they have been told, and which is right also, to take certain precaution about magnets, about motors, about cell phones, about radiation. So they will have all these questions, and we must know as physicians and cardiologists that pacemakers, like all electronic devices, can get affected by various these things. So we know that electromagnetic interference is everywhere. It may be in the hospital environment, it may be outside the hospital. And these electromagnetic waves can interfere with the pacemaker function or ICD function. In case of ICD, they prevent detection, or they may sometimes be seen as arrhythmia, may cause unnecessary shocks. In case of pacemakers, they may inhibit pacing and thereby causing risk to the patient. Now, some of the medical hospital environment EMI could be MRI, diathermy, lithotripsy, radiotherapy, and transcutaneous nerve stimulation. MRI was complete no-no some time back, but now the new pacemakers and ICDs, which have been approved for MRI, and they are available for last 5 years or 7 years, patients can undergo MRI, but with certain precautions, which I will discuss briefly. Diathermy is usually allowed unless directly over the pacemaker. Lithotripsy is also allowed unless directly over the pacemaker. Radiotherapy is also, if properly shielded, patients can undergo. Radiotherapy can damage the CMOS circuits inside the pacemakers. Transcutaneous nerve stimulation should be avoided. Anything where the current passes directly through the body should be avoided as far as possible. Then patients should avoid exposure to large magnets or large stereo exposure, meaning going very close to them within a foot or so. Power plants, big motors, car engines, running washing machines, they all can affect the function of pacemakers, and going very close to these should be avoided. And how much distance patient can go to close to these depends on the intensity of radiation. Like power plants and big motors and transformers, one should go maintain a distance of 3 to 4 feet. With the magnets, etc., 1 or 2 feet is enough. So one has to use sense. But some things are absolutely okay, like X-rays are fine, CT scan, mammogram, ultrasound, dental drills, they are all okay. Patients can use at home, they can use microwave ovens, TV remote controls, household appliances, massagers, kitchen mixers, electrical switches, all are safe, provided they are properly grounded. So patients should not keep anything which is like very loose connections or causing sparks and all that. They should have properly fitting plugs and sockets, so that then there is no problem and everything should be properly grounded. When the patients go to airport and malls, they can walk through the doors. Most of them are now compatible with pacemakers, and they don't affect the function of pacemakers and ICDs. But as far as possible, they can tell them not to put the handheld metal detector, which can sometimes interfere, although very, very rarely. Now, most of this scanning equipment has been made very safe. Now, from the MRI point of view, most of the patients are now, you know, they are getting MRI compatible devices, at least in India. And MRI is getting increasingly important because a lot of disease entities are now diagnosed by MRI. And patients who have an MRI compatible pacemaker, they also need a programming of the pacemaker to MRI mode before they undergo scan. And after the scan, they should be checked for the any malfunction, and then it should be reprogrammed to the normal mode. So it's not that patient who has an MRI compatible device, they can directly go to the MRI, but efforts are being made in that direction. That, in fact, it is already available in some pacemakers that once you program it in a certain way, as soon as patient goes into MRI environment, it will get activated and it can get automatically deactivated also. So, but most pacemakers currently available, they require to be programmed to MRI mode. So there's nothing which is like absolutely MRI safe. They are MR conditional. That is, within certain conditions, they are okay. So every pacemaker will have certain conditions which should be fulfilled. During surgery, sometimes your surgical colleagues may say that your patient has a pacemaker and what should I do? Ideally, the pacemaker should be programmed to an asynchronous mode, but it may not be possible. A pacemaker programmer may not be available. So we should stop sensing a pacemaker by just placing a small magnet over the pacemaker. Any simple small intensity pacemaker, I mean magnet, can be placed over the device and strapped with micropore or tape, so that the device becomes asynchronous, it stops sensing, and surgeon can apply cautery as much as they want. If nothing can be done, then they should try to minimize the cautery to small bursts so that it does not interfere with the pacemaker, and as far as possible, they should use bipolar cautery. Cell phone, it's okay to keep a distance of 6 to 15 centimeters. So 6 inches or 15 centimeters. And usually most of the pacemakers are now safe from cell radiation, cell phone radiation. Now, when a patient has pacemaker or ICD or whichever implantable device, they are prone to bloodstream infections. And if the lead develops endocarditis, it becomes a very difficult situation for the patient. It's a disaster because sometimes it may not be cured by IV antibiotics and we may have to remove the system, and removal or extraction, lead extraction, is a very, very difficult thing. So as far as possible, we should guide the patient that if they have to undergo a surgery or any dental procedure or any genitourinary procedure, they should take proper antibiotic as prophylaxis and avoid infective endocarditis as much as they can. So it's very important. Now, when a patient comes to the OPD for follow-up, we have to do certain things. We have to check the local healing end pocket. We check the pacing threshold. We check the sensing function, lead impedance, battery voltage, and we check the diagnostics. So a normal healing, the top picture on the right shows a normal healing pacemaker. Sometimes there may be some induration, swelling, which may indicate hematoma, or it may indicate infection. And sometimes a seroma can form over the pacemaker side. So it's bulging, but it's not, it doesn't look infected. So all these things should be checked. And we should also check for any development of fresh disease. Like, for example, patient may develop ventricular arrhythmia, so may have dizziness. Patient may develop heart failure because of continuous right ventricular pacing. So symptoms of heart failure should be inquired from the patient. We should examine the patient for any swelling, induration, redness, or tenderness. And then we use the programmer to check the device. We check the device parameters, lead integrity, battery voltage, and all the diagnostics that is now available in the, it's very complex, but it's available in all pacemakers, so that we can know what has been happening with the patient over the last few months. Now, and we must connect the ECG to check the pacemaker. Now, the problem with the pacemaker could be one with the pacing, that there may be a failure to capture, or there may be output failure. There may be problem with the sensing, like undersensing, oversensing, because every pacemaker is a demand pacemaker. So they're supposed to sense the intracardiac electrograms. And sometimes they oversense, sometimes they undersense. And then there could be arrhythmias related to the pacemaker itself. So coming to the capture and pacing threshold. Now, failure to capture can occur when the pacing stimulus does not result in myocardial depolarization. And there could be multiple causes. It could be electrode displacement, lead fracture, electrolyte disturbance, or there could be exit block. And what we see here is, we can see that there is a pacemaker which is dual chamber, because we can see two spikes. On the right side of the strip, we have atrial and ventral spikes. On the left side, we have P waves followed by ventral spike, but they're not capturing. So patient has a loss of capture, and patient has intrinsic very slow rhythm in the ventricle. And this picture also shows that there is a failure to capture in the ventricle. We can see that there are spikes here. V4, V5, we can see that there are spikes, but they're not producing any QRS. And this spike is producing a QRS. So there is an intermittent loss of capture in this particular example. Another patient with intermittent capture loss, we can see that there are regular spikes in the ventricle, but some are being captured, some are not being captured. And in this ECG, we can see that there is a loss of atrial capture. So you can see in the lead two bottom strip very clearly that the atrial spike is not followed by a P wave. So this is the atrial loss of capture. And the output, this can happen because of multiple reasons. And sometimes there may be no output from the pacemaker, and which can happen because of oversensing, lead fracture, loose set screw, or if there is a battery which is in end of life. So you can see here that the pacemaker is not pacing at all. The patient has a very slow ventricular rhythm, even though we know that the pacemaker was programmed to VVI 70, but patient has a heart rate which is very, very slow. We can see it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So it's even less than about 40 per minute. So this obviously is, there's no output from the pacemaker. So either the battery has run out or there is some lead fracture or faulty connection. Now, after pacing, we look for the sensing, whether pacemaker is sensing accurately or not, because they are supposed to sense native cardiac activity. And if pacemaker is not sensing, then we call it asynchronous pacing or undersensing. And this is a typical example of undersensing. What we see here is that there is a pacing going on. So first two beats are paced, third beat is sensed, but it's not, it is spontaneous, but not sensed by the pacemaker, which then gives a spike. The fourth beat is also native or spontaneous, but is not sensed by the pacemaker. It gives a spike, which is captured. So pacemaker is not sensing at all. And if we see the intracardiac channel, we can see that there's all V-pace activity, no V-sense at all. So that means the pacemaker is not sensing properly. And this can happen because of some improper, either the sensitivity is kept too low, or lead position is not good, or there may be some loose connection or lead fracture, whatever, is not sensing properly. So we have to correct it. Then oversensing, when the pacemaker senses something extraneous. So for example, if the pacemaker is supposed to sense the QRS and start sensing other T waves also, or some muscle activity also, or some extraneous out of the body things like electromagnetic interference. So all that is called oversensing, which may be intra within the patient's body or outside it also. So for example, in this strip, what we see is that there is a long pause here. The pacemaker is programmed to VVI 60. But it's not pacing at 60 because here there is a long gap. So it is getting inhibited by something, and the next cycle is also very long. So there is something which is inhibiting the pacemaker. And if we look at the marker channel, we see the first two beats are paced, all right. Third beat is properly sensed, but then there is some additional V sense here. Hello?
Go ahead, sir. Go ahead.
Yeah, okay. All right. So we see there is some additional V sense here, and which is inhibiting the pacemaker. So even though no activity is present, and this usually happens because of lead noise. And what we do for this is that we either reduce sensitivity, or we adjust the refractory period, or change to bipolar pacing, or avoid exposure. If it is EMI, then we avoid, tell the patient to avoid exposure to offending EMI. And sometimes if it is the noises coming from the lead, then we have to replace the lead. And I will show you how this lead noise can be produced. Now, you see here, what's happening here is this is a dual chamber pacemaker. And you see, what we see is a sense V pace. Second beat, A sense V pace. Third beat, fourth beat, fifth beat, sixth beat. We are all A sense and V pace. And then the seventh beat comes without any ACE. There's no P wave, but the ventricle is pacing. So the pacemaker might have sensed something here, which it, the pacemaker took as P wave, even though P wave is not present. And the same thing happens in the ninth beat also here, that there is no P wave, yet there is a ventricular pacing. So that means there is something additional which is being sensed. And so there is an A sense V pace here, even though there is a no P wave here. And what we see is there is some noise in the lead channel. So we can see that there is noise at multiple places here. And this usually happens because of a lead fracture. There is a make and break connection in the lead, which produces, this is a typical lead fracture noise. It is random, it is high amplitude, low frequency, and that's how it looks like. And that can cause unnecessary sensing. And this is a serious matter because we have to replace the lead. And you can see here, what's happening here is that there is a, you can see in the right panel, you can see that there is a compression of the lead. So it is getting compressed in the clavicular area, and which causes lead erosion. Sometimes there is a coil fracture, coil compression, and that can cause all these problems. So a simple way to understand is that if there is a fracture, then the impedance is increased. And if there is an insulation break, then the impedance is reduced. That's another patient showing. So most of the fractures occur in this region where the lead comes in close contact with the clavicle, because that is where it is exposed to all the external stress. And what you find is that the lead impedance will be high. As you can see in this particular example, the lead impedance is more than 2500. Then we check the battery voltage. And we know that the pacemaker battery typically lasts around 8 to 12 years. But now there are some pacemakers which can last up to 14, 15 years also. The ICD longevity is about 6 to 10 years, although ICDs are also now single chamber ICDs can last up to 11, 12 years. And we must ask the patient to come for regular follow-up. So a typical duration of follow-up is 6 months or so. In some patients who have ICD, who have LV dysfunction, who have heart failure, we tell them to come every 3-4 months for their own checkup, and then we check the device also. But if patient is otherwise healthy and doesn't need to come, then we can follow them every 6 months, sometimes even 1 year. And nowadays we have home monitoring available, so a significant number of patients are going home with a home monitoring equipment so that they can send their data periodically. If they are in doubt, they can check from home itself. And when the battery voltage becomes weaker, then we have to tell them to come every 2-3 months. That's called intensified follow-up period. And then once it reaches ERI, that is called elective replacement indicator, then we have to change the pacemaker or ICD box. So typically we just change the pacemaker box. We don't need to change the leads if the leads are performing very well. But if the impedance is very high or very low, or if threshold is very high, or there is some other problem with the lead, then we have to replace the leads also if the parameters are not very good. And as far as end of life care is required, if the patient is to be buried, then we can bury the patient with a device implanted, it doesn't matter. But if the patient is to be cremated, then we have to remove the device before cremation, and it should be turned off before removal and handed over to the patient or to the family. So I think that's all about pacemaker follow-up. I have kept the complex algorithms and device diagnostics for some other time because it was not possible to cover everything. But I'll be happy to answer if there is any question. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Excellent elaborate answer, sir. Lots of questions are here. Lots of questions. Again, also Badu sir, do you hear me? Badu sir, do you hear me?
Please, video on korte bolo.
Acha, ami korchi apni.
I think it has been a wonderful lecture. Very simply put, every important points has been elaborated. Yeah, that's all right. So I hope the audience has been entertained quite nicely by this beautiful simplistic lecture. And any initial novice cardiology who started implanting will be greatly benefited if they follow this advice, and if they keep this the record, which will be available later, they can follow it again and again. And if they have any problem, they can again consult and send the questions, their queries. At present, we have some questions. I think we'll be going through them. Mohsin, over to you.
Today we just change your program schedule. Just ask the question for the attendees first, then comments from the faculties. Because lots of questions from the attendees. Dr. Shahidul from Bogura, he also one of the panelists. Please ask a question. He's from the far away from the Dhaka city. So he's the first man to question to the Onil Saxena. Dr. Shahidul, do you hear me?
Unmute Shahidul, bhai.
Dr. Shahidul, do you hear me?
Dr. Yeah. Shahidul,
yes. Yeah, welcome. Please put your question. Thank you. To Dr. Saxena.
What? Just I have already written questions. What are the genuine What are the genuine indications of VVI pacemaker? Only VVI pacemaker. VVI or VVIR pacemaker.
So VVI
in present situations. Right?
The genuine indication is if the patient has atrial fibrillation, permanent atrial fibrillation, where we cannot pace the ATM at all. So patient would be benefited by VVI pacemaker or VVIR pacemaker. If the patient has some reason where we don't want rate response, for example, there are many patients with coronary heart disease who have angina at higher rates and we give them beta blocker, etc. to control the rate, there's no need for rate control there. But we can use VVI or VVIR in that situation. I think that is one genuine indication. Second could be a very old patient who is very fragile and emaciated, and where the overall survival is not very much, is somewhat limited, then we can use VVI. We don't need to give a dual chamber pacemaker there. But atrial fibrillation is one indication which is very important.
Any question, Dr. Shahidul?
Another question I have for the beginner during a subclavian venous puncture, if accidentally subclavian arterial puncture done, in those cases, how can we manage this case in that cath labs?
So mostly nothing will happen. So you
muscle bleeding, how can we assess?
It can happen, but usually bleeding doesn't happen much. So when we are doing venous puncture for pacemaker, we should be very, very alert to pull out the needle immediately in case we suck any air, or any, if we see arterial blood, or if we can immediately know that it's arterial blood. So if we see any air coming or any arterial blood coming, then we immediately pull out and immediately press that point for some time. And especially your question was on arterial puncture. So if arterial puncture, most of them will seal within 1 or 2 minutes. So this, and we can continue with our procedure. If patient has a high INR, then there could be a problem.
Can I add something?
Yeah, please.
Before doing the puncture, a venogram is actually very helpful.
It is very helpful.
But two, the artery is the elastic one. You are putting only a needle. If you do not put any stylus or introducer, it will not be that harmful. Just take out the needle, keep some pressure in there, wait 1 minute, and then proceed again. That's the most important thing. But you have to identify it very promptly.
Very promptly.
That's the most important thing.
There is a question, related question, that if the INR, they have asked, in my slide I showed INR should be less than 1.3, but if the patient has a prosthetic valve, then what should be done? So earlier the approach was that we would stop warfarin and put the patient on heparin, and then on the day of implant, we would not give a heparin injection and do the implant, and after 6 hours of implant, we would restart heparin as well as warfarin, and once the INR reaches 2, then we discontinue heparin. Now, we have changed this schedule, and most people feel that heparin causes more bleeding. So there have been many studies also in this regard, and now what is a good approach is that you allow INR to come down to around 1.8 or 2, and then do the procedure, and then continue with the anticoagulation. So it causes much less bleeding compared to shifting to heparin, and then heparin causes more bleeding, definitely. So one can do it at INR of 1.7 to 2.
Actually, sometimes the major surgery is even done, abdominal surgery, when the INR is less than 1.5. So that's much less harmful than heparin. Yes, it's a problematic. Now I find when the patient is getting DAPT, that's a troublesome thing.
That's most troublesome. So, in fact, much more troublesome than INR of 2 or 2.5. If you have to ask me which patient I will prefer to operate INR of 2 or dual antiplatelet, I would certainly choose one with the INR of 2 or 2.2.
I find that if the patient is getting only aspirin, if he stop it only 1 or 2 days, he can do it. But if the patient is getting clopidogrel, that's more powerful than aspirin, and the bleeding
continues. But increasingly we have to do it, because many patients have undergone stenting within a few months, and our colleagues, they say, don't stop, yes, you please do it. So, but we then guide the patient about higher possibility of hematoma.
What should the precaution, sir? If you continue ecosprin, what precaution is worrying?
One precaution is that we should spend more time in creating pocket, not be in a hurry. Go very slowly, keep clotting all the bleeding points, and preserve the pectoral fascia. Never go below the fascia, not lacerate the muscle. So if the muscle is lacerated, then keeps oozing. So we try to find the plane just above the fascia. There is an avascular plane, and we try to spend time gently separate that layer, and not be in a hurry, and keep, you can make the entire pocket. And then if you have ice cold saline, you can put it there. Otherwise, the bleeding stops, actually. So we have been very lucky in that sense. No major problem. Once in a while, it can happen that patient forms hematoma. But that's all care that we can do.
So are you using diathermy in the pocket?
Yes,
if needed?
We use diathermy.
Diathermy is very useful.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Apal, Dr. Shomin, do you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Please.
Ask your question.
I
have one question, sir. In our duty, we find so many patients who need pacemaker implantation. Initially, we put a TPI. And in the cath lab, after putting TPI, when it starts pacing, then patient feels better. But somehow, if the teeth gets dislodged, then patient may develop sometimes pacemaker dependence, and immediately develops VTE, and patient may need CPR at that time also. Are there any factors that determine that predict this situation?
Yes, one of them is the patients who have a bundle branch block. So, supposing there is a patient who has complete her block with a narrow QRS escape, that patient is less likely to become dependent, completely dependent or asystolic, because that patient will have a escape coming from the AV node. But patients who have a wide QRS rhythm, they are more prone to develop this kind of situation, that they become asystolic, CPR may have to be done. And so we have to be careful while placing the temporary. It should be properly secured. And if you put temporary from groin, it is much more stable compared to putting it from the jugular. So that is something which we have observed. And if we are careful, this situation should not arise. And then we can keep the output properly. You know, sometimes we have to increase output by the temporary pacemaker. But by and large, most patients, this would be a very rare situation that patient has asystole and wants to be resuscitated. But with adequate precautions, one can avoid it.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Dr. Atik, Dr. Rahman, Atik, you hear me?
Atik, cannot hear you.
So there's another question about MRI compatible pacemaker. That what will happen if a MRI non-compatible pacemaker is implanted and the patient undergoes MRI?
Yes,
and
sir.
The answer to that is nowadays there is very little chance that any harmful effect will come, because what happened was that all these pacemakers, they were, when they were initially designed in 50s and 60s and 70s, they had a lot of ferromagnetic material, and MRI was totally contraindicated at that time. After that, it remained a standard contraindication, but the way pacemakers were manufactured and fabricated changed. And so recently, when a lot of legacy pacemakers are being tested in MRI environment, we are finding that many of them are compatible with the pacemaker. So in US, there are a lot of studies and a lot of previously non-MR pacemakers and leads, they have been now certified as MR compatible, because sometimes it was necessary to do MRI, and then they studied those patients. It was done as a protocol, as a study, that what happens, and patients with, of course, with consent of patients, because it was so crucial to do MRI that they had to do it despite taking that small risk. And many of them have been recertified as MRI compatible. So in today's time, what we believe is that very little harm can come to the patient. One has to be careful about ECG monitoring and being ready for intervention if there is a need, but usually nothing happens.
Thank you, sir.
I have another question, sir. We are putting one tight bandage over the pacemaker after implantation. How long we should keep this bandage over the pacemaker? For how many days?
Our practice is to remove after 48 hours, but it can be removed after 24 hours. And we not only put a tight bandage, but we also put a sandbag over it. And some people put an ice cap over it, because ice being cold, it will cause vasoconstriction and reduce bleeding. Another important point to minimize chance of hematoma is that after the procedure, you should make the patient in the bed reclining at about 45 degree, because if the patient is lying flat, then the venous pressure can force some blood into the pocket. So if you raise the head end by about 45 degree, that also has an effect of reducing. And the blood pressure should be kept low. So some patients, and you can see during the procedure also, sometimes when there is a big spurt coming from the arterial, I immediately look at the blood pressure, and the blood pressure may be 170, 180, 200. So patients who have a higher blood pressure will tend to bleed more from the small arterioles into the pocket compared to the one who has a blood pressure around 100 or 110 or 20.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Rehan, do you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, please ask a question. And only one question should be asked, because yes, lots of questions here, lots of participants.
Thank you, sir, for your nice presentation. So my question regarding defibrillation. How can we defibrillate a patient with a pacemaker?
So pacemaker patients can be defibrillated, but we must keep the paddles somewhat away from the pacemaker body. So about 6 to 8 inches gap should be there from the paddle to the pacemaker.
That is the generator, isn't it?
From the generator, yes.
From the generator.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sudhir Shah. Do you hear me, Dr. Sudhir?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful presentation. We are really lucky to have a legend like you in this platform. We are getting benefited very much, sir. I have two simple questions, very simple questions. Sir, what is the basic difference between ICD and a pacemaker? And because we know that even pacemaker can be used to abort tachyarrhythmias by means of ramp pacing or the burst pacing. And I would also like to know about this ramp and the burst in simple language. Next question is, what will be the advice to a patient having a PPM regarding exercise, that how intense or for how long they can exercise?
Thanks.
So pacemaker patients can exercise, there's no problem. They can have normal, depending on their underlying disease. If the patient has only 6-hour syndrome or complete heart block and no other cardiac disease, patient can do normal exercise on the treadmill or whatever they want, they can do. As far as your question about the pacemaker being able to terminate ventricular tachycardia is concerned, it is true that pacemakers can, by giving a burst pacing, pacemaker don't have automatic burst pacing algorithms because they're not designed like that. But in the lab, you can give a burst and terminate a VT. That is possible. The reason why pacemakers have not given this anti-tachycardia pacing algorithms is that because sometimes it can accelerate ventricular tachycardia and rather convert it to fibrillation. And then pacemaker will have no mechanism to treat ventricular fibrillation. So that's why only ICDs are designed to have anti-tachycardia pacing, so that in case it accelerates to ventricular fibrillation, it can quickly cardiovert it. So that is the reason.
One question regarding the exercise. Some people ask, if I take a heavy weight or I'm cycling regularly or I'm swimming, is there any problem with or any increased incidence of lead fracture? That's the question people are asking.
Yes. So it is very relevant question, because the shoulder movement, although allowed, but they should not do very vigorous or too much shoulder movement, because this movement of clavicle over the first rib can obviously increase the chances of crush. But most of these patients are older patients, 50, 60, 70 years, and they ask how much weight they can carry. We typically tell them 5 to 10 kgs what they're supposed to carry. And most patients don't want to carry beyond that anyway. So up to 5, 10 kg, there's no problem.
In this regard, just the importance of doing axillary puncture or, if possible, cephalic vein cutout. In that case, you are really free from the only something of lead fracture.
Definitely.
The friction between
cutout and ventricle. I completely agree, because the lead will be inside the vein, outside the clavicle. So it will minimize
the pressure. Dr. Azharul Rafi, do you hear me? Please unmute yourself. Okay, please ask the question.
Thank you, Olin Saxena, sir, for your nice and simple presentation. Actually, sir, I have a couple of questions. First of all, if a patient has dual chamber pacemaker, and after implantation of pacemaker, if he develops atrial fibrillation or atrial flutter, then what will be the management protocol? And my second question is, sir, a person of ischemic origin complete heart block, if suppose a patient with acute STEMI following complete heart block, treated with revascularization strategy with PCI, and even after revascularization, if the complete heart block persists, then we usually put a temporary pacemaker for a while of 3 weeks. And even after 3 weeks, if a patient doesn't sinus rhythm and still persists complete heart block, and the patient is on DAPT, then what will be the management strategy? And my third question is,
Make it two, please.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
So, coming to the second question about the DAPT, we have to, the patient who maintains complete heart block beyond 2 weeks or 3 weeks, we have to implant a pacemaker. There's no doubt about it. Even though some patients may return to sinus rhythm, especially those who have inferior MI. Anterior MI don't recover easily, but inferior MI, most of them recover.
Right.
That's not a problem. What was the first question?
So first question was, if a patient develop atrial fibrillation.
Yeah, atrial fibrillation management should be more or less same. So we have to try to maintain the rhythm control as much as we can, give anticoagulation if required. And if we cannot, then we have to maintain rate control. And pacemaker comes in very handy in rate control, because we can use the rate control drugs very freely. And okay. We often put on the automatic mode switch so that the patient develops, whenever patient has atrial fibrillation or flutter, the pacemaker goes into DDIR mode or VVI mode. Can I explain it a little bit?
What Sal is saying is if it's a dual chamber pacemaker, yes, and then more switch means whenever there is atrial fibrillation, it will go to VVA.
Okay, so then what will be about atrial leak?
One more thing which can be done is if the patient is, supposing you are not able to control the ventricular rate, then you just have to disconnect the AV node, because you have already got atrial, you know, this thing, patient has dual chamber pacemaker, so you can produce a complete heart block, permanent complete heart block, and the patient will then be totally dependent on pacemaker, will not have high ventricular rate.
You know, that has been the reason for some case patients who require CRT and where we require 100% by IV pacing. Sometimes a AF patient, we put a complete heart block induced, yeah, and the patient is put on by IV pacing, absolutely, disregarding the atrial contribution.
Thank you very much, sir.
Dr. Khalik Jawan Bhai?
Sir, can I put in something?
Yeah.
Ulu, please give importance to the young implanters, how they can be sure they have implanted the screen lead in the septum, in mid septum or lower mid septum, not in the anterior free wall. Which views they should be using to be sure of that?
Yeah, so LAO view, I showed one slide. If you see in LAO view, the pacemaker tip should point towards the spine and not the other side. So then, you know, and second pointer will be a narrow QRS complex. If you implant it in free wall, then it will be wide QRS complex.
I'm telling because in epi view, you will feel that you have done the right thing. Yes. Similar way,
absolutely,
both anterior free wall or in the septum. But whenever you are using the LAO view, you will find out whether the tip is towards the spine or towards the sternum. If it is towards the sternum, then it is in the free wall.
Dr. Khalik Jawan.
Ms. Saxena for a wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
I have two questions. Number one is that before inserting the generator into the pocket, we have the habit to do a generator, antibiotic flush inside the pocket and then to insert the pacemaker. How much it is justifiable, number one, or defective? Number two is that I am telling about the setting of acute inferior MI with RV infarction where the permanent pacemaker become indicated. Is there any reservation to use active of screw lead where the myocardium is inflamed friable? Thank you, sir.
I think both questions are very good. So if we use after the infarction, if we have to use it after maybe 2 weeks, if it doesn't recover, then if you're doing septal pacing, then it doesn't matter. There's no problem with the septal pacing, because one should avoid RV apical pacing, because that may be infarcted, part of the infarct, and it may perforate more. What was the first question?
Giving antibiotic in the
pocket. Yeah, so our practice is not to flush the pocket with the antibiotics, but we always inject the antibiotic after the first layer. So our practice is that while closing, after first layer or second layer, before we complete the closure, we inject antibiotic, and usually we use either amikacin or gentamicin for that purpose.
That means between the deeper layer and the superficial layer, and you will be injecting
that. Before we finally close it, huh?
Yeah.
So that it stays in the pocket.
Thank you. Dr. Mustafa Rahman Palash, do you hear me?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Anil Saxena, sir. It's a pleasure for us to have
a... Mustafa Rahman, you have another mobile. I think so. You have another mobile. Please off this mobile. I think you have two devices used. Mobile and laptop.
Too much ego.
You should.
Too much ego.
The one. Yeah.
That's.
Okay. Mute one device. Okay. Ask a question.
We cannot hear you.
We cannot hear you because I think you flash. Open your earpiece and please open your earpiece. and talk directly. Disconnect your
Palash, take out the earpiece and talk directly to the device. That will be helpful. Yeah. Like that.
Directly. Yeah.
Yeah, good.
Yeah.
Okay, you will talk directly.
We cannot hear you still.
No. Asif Tushar, please.
Unmute yourself.
Unmute first. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you, sir. Again, thank you, Dr. Anil Saxena, sir.
My pleasure.
A great teacher, a great humanity, a great human being. Sir, many a times what we find in our system, not many times, but I got one or two cases that the patient came 1 or 2 years after his last reported checkup of pacemaker showing ERI or EOL, in fact. But still the patient had low pacing. So in this situation, or how long the patient can remain reasonable with pacemaker generator gone or EOL after
emergency mode.
Yes.
So what happens is that the pacemakers are designed in a manner to preserve itself as long as possible. So supposing there is a DDDR pacemaker, the first thing that will happen is it becomes a single chamber pacemaker. Then it switches off all the diagnostics, all the memory functions and all that to save battery. Then it starts pacing at slower rate. And so supposing the program rate may be 70, but will start pacing at 65, then 60, then 50. So it tries to preserve its own life as long as possible, because some patients may or may not be able to reach the hospital. So, and it's quite variable across all batteries, you know, even from the same manufacturer, the batteries behave in a different manner. But the end of life curve may be different in different batteries. So there are two important points when the pacemaker, so the new pacemaker used to be 2.8 volts. Now some pacemakers have 3.2 volts also. But gradually, when the voltage declines below 2.6 or 2.5, then patients go into what is called ERI mode. And when it starts going below 2.4 volts or 2.3 volts, then it goes into EOL. That is, it's not supposed to pace. But some patients, especially those who have lower thresholds, they keep on pacing till very long, another few months. And some patients will not pace.
And sir, is there any incidence of runaway pacemaker in these days?
No, not really. We don't have not. I've not seen a single patient actually in the last 20, 30 years.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Abdullah Al-Jamil. Dr. Abdullah Al-Jamil, do you hear me? Dr. Abdullah Al-Jamil?
Jamil, are you here?
Dr. Jamil?
No, he's probably not there.
Khaled Mohsin Bhai is here. Professor Sufia Rahman Madam is here.
Dr. Khaled Mohsin, sir.
Thank you, sir, for your nice presentation. I have just one or two questions for you. When you implant a RV pacing in a septal position, do you use a preformed stylet or the Mont stylet, or you shape the stylet yourself according to your choice?
So we shape the stylet according to, like, the Mont stylet, as you're suggesting. It's like a AL2 or AL3, that kind of shape, implants coronary catheter shape. So we shape it accordingly and then we use it.
And in your experience, do you have any late metal allergy in patients?
Not really, because what is sometimes seen as a late erosion or late allergy may actually be some infections, very low grade smoldering infection, which eventually comes out, and it's not even culture may be negative, but usually allergy is not heard of it, not seen. It's difficult to separate it also from low-grade indolent infection. There is because one cannot say whether it was infection eventually leading to erosion or bursting of the pocket, or it was allergy. It's very difficult to comment.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Dr. Shahjahan Kabir, he's from Malaysia. Dr. Shahjahan Kabir.
Mohsin, I'm here again.
Oh, Jamil Bhai, Dr. Jamil. Dr. Abdul Jamil, please. Put him, please. few comments and also maybe ask question. Okay.
Good afternoon, sir. Onis sir.
Good afternoon. Hi, Dr. Jamil.
How are you?
Fine, thanks.
I have no question. It was a nice presentation, though I couldn't hear fully as I was attending some patients in the chamber. It was nicely said, everything. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shahjahan Kobir. You hear me? Yeah.
Thank you, sir, for your nice deliberation nice. Presentation, sir. Sir, I just want to know regarding the CPR in the stage of cardiac masses. Is there any precaution we have to for any patient having the pacemaker as well as the...
No, not really. Not. I mean, chest compression, there's no problem with pacemakers. With ICDs, one has to be careful because one can get a mechanical shock. The ICD may be firing at the same time when you're doing chest compression and you may feel the ICD shock a little bit. But pacemaker, there's no problem. And if you have to defibrillate the patient, then you have to keep the paddle away. About 6 inches to 8 inches away from the pacemaker body. That's all.
One of the interesting question in the chat box. If it is mandatory to remove the pacemaker after death or decease?
Yeah, I think I covered that point. If the patient is to be buried, then there is no problem. One can, there's no need to remove. But if the patient needs to be cremated, then the manufacturers have advised that the pacemaker should be removed. But many families don't agree to that, and we have not encountered any problem. But there was a time, these guidelines were also from the time when pacemakers were quite big. And because if when you cremate a patient, then because of heat effect, it may cause a minor explosion.
Yeah. So
that was the fear.
Nice.
Can I have a question?
Yes.
Let's say we have implanted a patient, and after 3 months or 4 months, he came back with infection, and he find out that he had to remove the whole thing. And in case of, after 6 months, in that case, is it safe to unscrew the ventricular screen lead and take it out?
Yes. So that can be unscrewed anytime. And in fact, in very chronically implanted pacemaker, the screw is so small, it doesn't cause any problem. Even if you don't unscrew it, it won't bring out any tissue because it's very, very small screw. It is just there to hold the lead in the absence of any traction. That screw doesn't cause any real fixation that you cannot remove it. So that is not. And within 1 or 2 years, it can be unscrewed also. Sometimes what we have seen is after 5-10 years, it may not be possible to unscrew it. But when we pull it back, it just gives way easily, very easily. It doesn't have much holding power. That is small screw.
That means it's easier than the usual tine leads.
Tine lead. But the main impediment to extraction or removal lead is one is tip fixation, and second is there may be sidewall adhesions. Because many of these leads, they are attached to the, they are very close to the atrial wall or in the venous channel, they may be very close to the wall. And it may form a lot of adhesions around the lead. And that prevents the lead from being taken out. So we have to put a sheath, cutting sheath, etc. to cut sidewall adhesions.
Thank you, sir.
That means in those cases, this should be sent actually to a specialist center.
Yeah.
Where they are experienced in doing so.
Right.
Thank you, sir. We have asked delighted Professor Sukhir Rahman. He is our pioneer interventional cardiologist in Bangladesh. I think we are very much honored to be here. Madam, please put your comments, sir. Madam, do you hear me?
Sophia, madam, hey. Madam, please unmute. Madam. Sophia, madam, please unmute.
Maybe she's briefly away from the computer. Yeah.
Network.
Right. Madam. Okay, Professor Jalal, sir. Please unmute yourself. Sir is here with us. He also is a pioneer pacemaker.
Yes, I know Professor Jalal.
Actually, all of us are his student.
Yeah.
Professor Sipir Rahman, Professor Jalal.
Thank you very much. Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I thank Dr. Anil Saxena. I met him several times beforehand. He's so wonderful speaker. And today's speech, he did not keep anything to be questioned more. Though our juniors have put some questions for their when they are in doubt to do something in the pacemaker setting. I have one thing that I started facing. Previously, the pacemaker was implanted by the surgeons in the before 1980s. In the early 80s, the physicians started facing. I started facing since 1983. At the time, we implanted only the BBI pacemaker, later on BBIR, later on dual chamber pacemaker. But I didn't go for any ICD implantation. One thing that when the patient is very old and skin is very thin, I implanted two or three pacemakers in the subpectoral region. Do you practice this one at the present moment?
Yes, sir. So if the patient is very thin, emaciated, and fragile, then we separate the belly-pectoral muscle and put it under it.
Yes, thank you very much. Another thing, about 20 years back, I implanted some pacemaker that is single lead dual chamber, that is atrial sensing and ventricular pacing. But at this moment, we are not using this one.
VDD. What is it called? The VDD pacemaker.
VDD.
VDD. VDD.
VDD.
Yeah, there was a VDD pacemaker which had only one lead, and then there were two sensors in the atrial portion. Now, somehow the manufacturers, we also implanted a lot of them. For about 5 years or 10 years, we implanted a lot of them. And I used to like it because it was economical for the patient, and it was quite easy to implant and all that. But then it has been, most of the manufacturers have stopped making it. It was not maybe very popular worldwide, so whatever. But I agree with you, it was a very good thing to do.
But somebody says that if the patient is implanted with VDD pacemaker, this patient, when they become older and age increases, the patient may develop six sinus syndrome. In that case, it is very difficult to maintain with this pacemaker.
So then we did upgrade some of those patients, and we had to then put additional atrial lead because this lead cannot pace the atrium. So then we had to put additional lead.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
For your nice delivery.
I'm
very much charmed.
Professor Sufia,
Professor Sufia, good afternoon, ma'am. How are you?
Good afternoon. Very nice to see you, Dr. Saxena.
Thank you so much.
You look very young.
Oh, thank you so much.
you have presented excellent case. You can say A to Z. You have not left anything out. That's excellent. And I think it will help our juniors very much.
Thank you,
ma'am.
It was meant for them, actually.
Of their experience. And nice to see my all students are very active in this COVID era. And I can see one of my junior, a senior colleague as well, Professor Jalal. So nice to see you all. And all the questions were very nice to the point you have answered. I'm really glad to see the very successful meeting.
Thank you so much.
I wish all of you stay safe and be good with the health. Okay.
Thank you.
Madam, it's an honor to have you amongst us.
Thank you, madam. Take care.
Nice to see you all.
Dr. Mohsin and Dr. Chaudhary have designed a beautiful program. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Yeah. Professor Athar,
sir. Athar, unmute, please.
He's only
section
of Bangladesh.
Athar, unmute, please. Yeah. Athar is only section as disciple, so the qualities rub off on him.
But I think sir is more popular than me in our country. He is our teacher. Really, he is our teacher. You have become a teacher of Bangladesh, sir.
Thank you so much.
Actually, this is such a type of lecture. It does not need introduction. I think it is the summary of several lectures. Sir has covered several lectures in a single lecture in a nice way. I don't have any question to be unanswered. I think our participant will also have got all the questions. I want to share my personal problems, sir. One is, sir, how do we measure the P waves, R waves, and the threshold in a TPM dependent patient's complete heart block who is undergoing the pacemaker, sir?
Yeah, so one reason why we want to measure R wave is to have pacemaker function in a demand manner, that when patients, the pacemaker should be able to sense the native R wave. But patients who don't have any R wave, there it does not really matter. So because you cannot sense the native R wave, all you can sense is the paced R wave. Right. So we like to measure the paced R wave, but that's all one can do probably.
Sir, another is that, sir, in our country particularly, there are several operators does several things, particularly in case of the pacemaker pocket infection, that is not uncommon. Many a times, we use the new pacemaker, fresh pacemaker again after removing the infected one, and sometimes we reuse it, sir. That is, sometimes we can put out all the system, that is the pacemaker and the lead, then we sterilize it and again reuse it on the other side. And sometimes we partly, there is only generator can be removed, keeping the lip intact. Then we use the other side, that is after sterilization of the generator. Sir, this is, I think, is, this should not be the, sir, what is your experience about this, sir? This is our practice. That is,
the thing is that chances of infection are definitely more if we reuse the pacemaker. But to minimize the chances of reinfection, but everybody cannot, patients sometimes cannot afford a new pacemaker. So we have to use sometimes. But as far as possible, we should not use the same leads. So we should remove the leads and keep the patient on temporary pacemaker. And then in the meantime, we should prepare the pacemaker very well. We have to scrub it very well to remove any biofilm, because these bacteria, the infection produces a biofilm on the pacemaker body, and which may contain some spores of the bacteria. So we should do proper scrubbing of the pacemaker with the gauze pieces and betadine and all that, and then keep it in Sidex for a day, and then we should wash it and then sterilize it at least twice with ETO at low temperature, around 70 degrees. And we should be ready to be reused. But two, three things are important. Should be biofilm should be definitely removed. It should be properly scrubbed, and we should re-sterilize it twice.
Okay, thank you, sir.
And Dr. Anisil Awal is from Chittagong. Chittagong also doing lots of pacemaker, dual chamber, ICDs, also leadless pacemaker also. Dr. Anis.
Good afternoon, sir. It's nice to see you and hear from you. I went to your center for 7 days in 2014, I had a wonderful experience.
Yeah, thank you.
Sir, I had experience about lead endocarditis, sir. One of my patients developed lead endocarditis. Initially, he was presented only, it was a dual chamber pacemaker. And for economic reason, it was a screw in the ventricular lead and atrial lead was tying lead, sir. And what happened, he developed fever after 4 or 5 months like that. And we were trying with different antibiotics, pocket was totally clean. And we are not getting any evidence. And on that time, echo was also normal. But after several months, in transesophageal echo, it was shown there are visitation. And later on, a visitation also appears on the transthoracic echo also. So we had a lot of discussion what to do. Then finally, we call out our cardiac surgeons. And then we attempted to unscrew, and we can take out the ventricular leads, but atrial lead we couldn't take out. Then finally, we decided to open it up. So, and patient's economic condition, he cannot afford another dual chamber pacemaker. Then we put a single chamber. Cardiac lead was given. He is now doing fine and he became afebrile. Now, I want to know what is your practice, sir?
Yeah, it may be required some time. So if supposing the patient cannot be cured by antibiotics and has persistent lead endocarditis and a transvenous lead extraction is not possible, then we have done in 2-3 patients that patient had to undergo surgical removal of the pacing system and epicardial LV lead at the same time, because some patients are dependent on pacemaker. So you cannot keep temporary pacemaker for a long time. And if you implant a permanent pacemaker very quickly, transvenously, then again the new system can also get infected. Yeah. So, but if you put an epicardial lead and single chamber pacemaker as a intermediate approach, it's very good. And some patients may want to as a long-term approach also. So that's a very good approach, what you did, because the chances of reinfection are minimum with that.
Sir, I think...
Reinfined for last 2 or 3 years, sir.
Yeah, definitely.
Sir, in that case, if we put epicardial lead on the LP, that will be more beneficial, I think.
Definitely.
Thank you. Dr. Arun Maske from Nepal.
Arun is in good evening. Yes, I think.
Yeah.
Arun, unmute, please.
Arun, you need to unmute.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was planning to attend his lecture. I missed some of all his lectures. So I'm in the discussion part. Anyway, nice to see. I'll see you in YouTube.
Thank you. Thank you.
YouTube also. You can find it.
Yeah. Yeah. You'll get the lecture, of course.
Dr. Arif, thing left in the chat box.
Sir, most of the question. At first, I'd like to thank Arun Saxena, sir. I had been his trainee for this. Sir, you have nicely discussed almost all the questions already discussed. There's a few questions I want to add with them. Dr. M.A. Mutin from Feni Hospital, he wanted to know how we can prevent development of pneumothorax and what will be the steps, whether we should postpone the procedure of development of pneumothorax or what will be the management, sir?
Yeah, so pneumothorax, one can immediately, you see, as I said earlier also, that one should be very careful while doing subclavian puncture and be ready to pull it out immediately if there is air in the syringe. So, because if you pull out immediately, then the injury to the lung is, and the pleura is minimized. But if you allow it to be there, then patient breathes on the needle, then obviously the lung may get a tear and the pneumothorax will increase and persist and you may have to put in a drainage. Otherwise, most of the pneumothoraxes, they can be just left alone. It's very mild to moderate, can be left there like that only. You need to give the patient 100% oxygen. If it is moderate to severe, sometimes aspiration, needle aspiration is sufficient next day or within a few hours. So you can aspirate it with the help of a needle from the back, making the patient bend forward. And very rarely you have to put the drainage, the tube in, intercostal tube. That's very rare. Most of the pneumothorax, even if it happens, it can be managed medically.
One thing is that whenever you are doing an axillary puncture, you see that you are beyond the clavicle and the rib cage. You are outside the rib cage. And there is no way a pneumothorax can occur. That's a very helpful thing if you follow a venograph and do that.
Right. Thank you, sir.
I like to add one thing. Venogram is helpful for the beginners. Now I have done this for more than 10 years. I don't do venogram anymore. I do directly and usually I succeed. If I fail, then I go for venogram.
So you're habitual with this, sir?
Yes, sir.
It depends upon the experience, 100% of course.
I do excellence.
Other result, do you comment about the venogram? I think so expert other result doing the venogram every cases. So what's your opinion, sir? Other result.
I'm also a Methodist. I want to follow the
methods. For the juniors. Other result, unmute yourself.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
If there is no contraindication of the contrast, most of the time I like to do the venogram as become it makes the things easier.
Yeah.
And it needs the less puncture, and most of the time in a single or two puncture I'll succeed. So I like to do it practice, sir. And most of the time I do the axillary puncture rather than the subclavian puncture. So for the axillary puncture, I think it is better to use the venogram. Without venogram, it is easy to do the subclavian puncture, not the axillary puncture. But for the axillary puncture, what I like, I usually prefer. I want to see comment from the Saxena sir.
I agree with you. For axillary, it is better to have a venogram.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. The last question. The last question from the Sanjida Ansari. She's from Malaysia. Welcome, Sanjida. Please put your question. Yeah.
I'm from Nepal, sir.
Oh, Nepal. Sorry.
Thank you, sir, for giving me the opportunity to ask you a question. My question is regarding the management. So what would be the management of Twiddler syndrome and the management of intravascular thrombosis?
Yeah, so intravascular thrombosis sometimes can happen because of the pacemaker lead. So some patients, 1 or 2% may come back with some swelling in the arm or forearm after 1 week or 2 weeks. And usually we have to give them anticoagulant for some time. So, and that usually suffices. Giving them anticoagulant, even we can use heparin or we can use oral anticoagulation using NOACs for maybe 2 to 4 weeks. That should be sufficient to reduce swelling. But chronically, many patients develop venous thrombosis. And when we have to upgrade or do lead replacement, we find that 10 to 15% patients may have subclavian vein occlusion. So that's a chronic problem. But in the acute phase, we can give anticoagulation and help the patient. The second part was about Twiddler syndrome. So Twiddler syndrome is very, very rare now. And usually we tell the patient not to touch the pocket, not to move try to move it. But still sometimes it can happen if the pocket is loose, if the pocket is too big. So one precaution one should do is not to make a very big pocket. So it should be just optimum. If it is tight, then it can help with the lead, with the erosion of the pocket because of device. If it is too loose, then it can cause Twiddler syndrome also. There's a third thing which is called Reel syndrome. Sometimes what happens is that when we make a coil of the lead, the extra length of lead is made into a coil and put in the pocket itself along with the pacemaker. So it should be, one should take care that the coil should be under the pacemaker, not around the pacemaker. So if the pacemaker is coiled around the pacemaker body, then with the arm movement, the pacemaker body will rotate and can pull the lead into the pocket. And so rarely you come across an X-ray of a patient that the entire lead is pulled up and you don't know how it got pulled up. So that it happened because of the Reel effect, that the pacemaker, that the lead is wound around the pacemaker body. And so one should make sure that the pacemaker extra length coil is smaller than the pacemaker and is put under the pacemaker, not around the pacemaker.
Thank you, sir.
Can I put something?
Yes.
For the young implanters, you should make sure that the length of the lead, if it's a big person, 57 centimeter. If it's a smallish person, take care that it should be 52 millimeter.
Yeah.
Then this extra length of lead should not be there.
Completely agree.
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir. So I think I have to get the one question from the Sillet. Dr. Shoya from Sillet, he wanted to know how to detect pacemaker-mediated tachycardia and how to manage it, sir.
Oh, that will be a long topic. I have the slides actually, but I have not wanted.
Sir, I think you should have another lecture for that.
Should go for that.
I think we need to know a lot more about that subject.
Definitely.
We also are interested in that.
Oh, thank you, sir.
We'll be waiting. We have already spent almost 2 hours time. Dr. Olin Saxena, sometimes we're knocking you, and I think we disturb more lecture for you. Before ending, Dr. Mr. Devastrita, about CRM, please give the vote of thanks from you. Thank you, for your team.
Thank you, sir.
With us for the technical department. Okay.
Thank you. It's a pleasure. It's a pleasure from our end to Dr. Saxena, who never said no to us. Any training request which goes to Dr. Saxena across the India and Bangladesh and Nepal, he never said no. And thank you to all of you senior doctors, those who are from Bangladesh, those who are very close to my heart because my mother is from Bangladesh. So I believe it's part of my country. So my father is from India and mother is from Bangladesh. So it's close to me. So thank you so much for your excellent presentation. But whenever I go and visit in the country, I see in case of eastern part of the country and Bangladesh, many a time nurses touches the pacemaker when I open it, give it to the table, and they touch and they hand it over to the doctor, and then doctor put it to the patient, and the infection rate, as many hands it goes out, the infection rate eventually increase. So do you comment how to put the pacemaker, open it from the box at last, and give it to the patient? So a last comment on that, because my intention is to reduce the pacemaker related infection as much as possible. So last comment from me.
I think it's a very, very important point, Devshita, you're making. So the practice in my lab is that we never open anything till it is to be ready to be put into the body. And whether it is sheath, whether it is suture, whether it is pacemaker, whether it's lead, it should be opened just before it is to be put into the body. And only one person should handle it. There's no reason for people to change hands. It may fall also by changing of hands. And as such, it is best to not be even exposed to the air for a long time, not more than a minute. Yeah. Just to take it out and put it in the body as quickly as possible. All implants.
Right, right. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Mohsin and Dr. Professor Wadul and Dr. Attar and all. My grateful gratitude to Dr. Mohsin and Dr. Wadul for making such a wonderful forum on each and one of you, each and one of the doctor are here. I'm glad to see almost 200 people in every day with 2 hours presentation. Thank you so much. Thank you, all of you. And we'll definitely connect as long as whenever my requirement is there, I'm there for you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Professor Abdul, sir.
We have been enthralled by the beautiful lectures and the interactive discussion we have had for the last 2 hours. And it's really a pleasure, a delight, and a refresher of the mind in this desperate situation. This kind of interaction is really heartening. Thank you, Professor Saxena. And we'll be eagerly waiting for more lectures from you on different aspects. We'll be really asking for it. And dear audience, you can rest assured, Professor Saxena has the capacity of making things, very complicated things, very palatable. And he can make things from easier to very harder. So we have learned the very basic things. We'll be going into a little bit deeper in future.
Definitely. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everybody. We'll be seeing you again and again and again.
Thank you. We are so much delighted. Professor Subhira Ram, madam, here. Professor Jalal, sir.
Thank you, sir.
We are really encouraged more to the program. Dr. Jamil, Dr. Yes. Adarli, sir. Thank you all. Especially thanks, Professor Onil Saxena.
Thank you so much.
We are knocking later. Okay, sir. Also, thanks, Devastrita, about CRM. Thanks, Incepta Pharmaceuticals. Incepta with us for last 2 months. They are our technical partner. And also, Dr. Arifurman Shajol. He is our soldier. And our king, Professor Abdullah Chaudhary. Thank you, sir. Next class on 14th July. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Great. Thank you so much.
On 14th July, on Tuesday, at 3 p.m., Dr. Kobiruzzaman, he will talk on evaluation of aortic as valvular disease on echocardiography, echo class on valvular disease. Till then, goodbye. Allah Hafiz. Stay safe and take care, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum, Shabaiki.
Assalamu alaikum, and thank you. Very nice.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.